Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
So the clocks changed this week, which is great. They changed by an hour and 5 minutes. So you might think we're 5 minutes late. Actually, we're starting right on time, which is excellent. Wonderful to see everybody here. What a beautiful fall day it is. Don't get used to these temperatures, okay? Because I think this is the last of it. But anyway, it's all good. A couple of things as you came in, don't forget your communion packs. If you want to say communion with us, they're at the back. And then the empties goes in the bowl at the back afterwards. And we've been going through Mark's Gospel. There are still some copies of this at the back. If you get one, don't forget to put your name on it. And we'll be using this both on Sunday and on Wednesday as we go through the year at various times. Inside it, actually, there is a sort of a calendar. And you'll notice that when we get to December, we're not studying Mark, and that's because on Sundays, we're going to go through the Advent brief and look at love, joy, hope, and peace. On Wednesdays, we're going to look at the second in the series on The Chosen. We watched the first of the series of it over the summer, and this is the second series, and those are available to you free via the internet. I don't think the second series is on Peacock, you've got that. I've got DVDs as well. But we'll be watching those here on Wednesday. Just a couple of other announcements, and then we've got a beautiful song from Bruce in a moment. On page 10 in the bulletin, if you've got that, if not, don't worry. St. Matthew, who's our partner church, they're hosting a grief share event, which is called Surviving the Holidays. It's a seminar on Sunday, November the 14th, next week, between 2 and 4:30. And that's a really helpful time if you've lost someone and Christmas is just a hard time, Thanksgiving's a hard time to get through for you. That's a great opportunity to come together with people also struggling with the team there at St. Matthew and have some useful helps on taking you through that. And also on page 2 in our bulletin, if you haven't got it, don't worry about Thanksgiving. I want you to know that if there's anybody here that will find themselves by themselves on Thanksgiving, please let me know. If there's anybody that you know won't have a meal at Thanksgiving, again, please let us know. And we'll see what we can do to connect you with others and to provide people you know of with a meal at Thanksgiving. It's something that we also do, and it's just so easy. You go to Lund's, you pre-book a meal, and you can give it to somebody who just, Thanksgiving would just be any other normal day, unless people are able to give them a turkey and stuff and these extra things. And we want to be able to bless people in that way. Bruce is going to come and bring us a song in a moment. Just invite you in the quietness to come before the Lord, recognizing that we're in God's house. And as you come before the Lord in quietness, bring to Him your struggles and your frustrations. Also bring to Him your joys, knowing that we'll give Him thanks and praise. Just be quiet for a moment and I'll say a prayer and then we'll hear this song. Father God, thank you for bringing us into your house this morning. Lord God, we pray that as we gather here, you may fill this place with your Holy Spirit. Lord God, that you may use this opportunity to draw us closer to you, to help us keep our eyes fixed on you as you send us out into the world. Lord God, as we read your word, as we come before you in prayer, as we receive from you in the sacrament, Lord God, bless this time, we pray. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And so our worship this morning begins in the way our lives in Christ in baptism began. In the name of God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Prayer that's on the screen on page 3 in the bulletin. We say together, Heavenly Father, the perfect sacrifice of Jesus is enough to forgive the sins of every person that has ever lived. We need that forgiveness today. Our words, our thoughts, and our actions have hurt our neighbor and offended you. We repent of our sin and look to you for forgiveness. Forgive us, Lord, and renew us, desire and power to do what you command. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Brothers and sisters, as we come to the Lord God in confession, we know that there's nothing that we have done. It's all because of Jesus Christ and his sacrifice for each one of us. So hear this today, hear this good news today, that because of Jesus, your sins are forgiven. In the name of God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now we're going to sing a moment for all the saints. Last week was Hallowed Eve, the evening before All Saints Day. Today we think about All Saints. Last weekend we also thought about the Reformation, when Martin Luther nailed the 95 Theses onto the castle door. Today is also a day we'll remember veterans in our prayers. And I'm wearing a poppy here. In England, a lot of people will wear a poppy. It commemorates, also raises funds for veterans. Poppies were out there on the fields at Agincourt in the First World War when they had the battles. So we've got a number of things in service, but this is a hymn for all the saints. Helps us remember all those who've gone before us, who paved the way. So if you're able to, will you please stand with me as we sing together.
Thank you.
connects in with it being All Saints today. And then another reading from 1 John. The reading from Revelation that Elaine's going to bring us actually is a response. So I'm afraid you can't just sit back. She'll read the V part. If you could join in the C part. So, Elaine.
Since this reading is about praising God in the first two verses, I would like it if you would really be excited about like you are really praising God. This is John's vision of heaven, and it's in Revelation 7, verses 9 through 17. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice,
"Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne and to the Lamb."
All the angels are standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worship God, saying,
"Amen.
Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God ever and ever.
Amen."
Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they and where did they come from?"
I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said,
"These are they who came out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them in his presence. Never again will they hunger, never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor the scorching heat."
The Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is written in 1 John 3, 1 through 3. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known to us. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks for letting us come to our Gospel of Mark reading, and this is what we're going to be focusing our sermon on. Remember last week we thought about the parable of the sower. Jesus is going to continue his teaching pieces, if you like. So the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory be to you, O Lord. And so Jesus said to them, "Is a lamp brought in to be put under a basket or under a bed and not on a stand? For nothing is hidden except to be made manifest, nor is anything secret except to come to light. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear." And Jesus said to them, "Pay attention to what you hear. With the measure you use, it will be measured to you, and still more will be added to you. For to the one who has, more will be given. And from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away." And Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. He sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. The earth produces by itself, first the blade, then the ear, then the full grown in the ear. But when the grain is ripe, at once he puts in the sickle, because the harvest has come. And Jesus said, with what can we compare the children of God, the kingdom of God? Or what parable should we use for it? It is like a grain of mustard seed, which, when sown on the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes larger than all the garden plants and puts out large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shades. With many such parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them without a parable, but privately to his own disciples, he explained everything. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Before we have our message, we're going to sing again, Holy, Holy, Holy. If you're able to, please stand with me as we sing together. So, as we've gone through, we've been studying Mark's Gospel, and if you remember the first couple of weeks, we kept coming up with the word immediately. You remember that? We even said there were like 41, 42 mentions of the word immediately in Mark's Gospel. And everything was moving really, really fast. But now it's as though everything is suddenly taking a breath. It slowed down. And last week, we had the first of those parables of Jesus teaching. The parable of the sower, or I like to think of it, the parable of the seeds and the four types of soil. And today we're going to move on also to some more teaching when Jesus is going to use, first of all, the illustration of a lamp. And again, you can imagine that he's picking up on pictures that people would know. As they walked into the home, they knew they had to put a lamp on in order to see. I mean, we do know that, don't we? That if you walk into a dark room or if the power's gone out, you find a candle, you get your flashlight on your phone, wherever it is, so that you can actually see. You don't do that and then suddenly cover over the light, right? It doesn't make sense. And Jesus actually asked this obvious question, well, who would do that? And of course, no one would do that, right? That he know that if you need light, you turn it on and you let everybody see it. It just seems obvious. And if you read in John 8, Jesus also makes it clear that he is the light. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And Isaiah, written 700 years before Jesus came, talks about this light that was to come. It's one of those readings we have at Christmas time, a light to lighten the Gentiles. And that's really important, a light to lighten the Gentiles. It's one of the things that the Jews had forgotten about. They were looking for this light, but they'd forgotten that this light wasn't just for them exclusively. Jesus has come for the whole world. Now, if you look in our version, this talks about how the light was brought in to the room. Actually, if you go back, I don't often look at the Greek words, but if you look at the Greek in some words, you get a better explanation. And in the Greek, it actually said the light comes in. The light came into the room. Jesus comes into the world. Jesus came to be with each one of us, sent by the Father to bring us healing and forgiveness and restore our relationship with him. But for the minute, Jesus is going to say some things are still actually hidden. They're kept secret, and that's what Jesus is going to have to explain things to his disciples later on. But later on, when Jesus is hanging on the cross, and then when he rises to new life, that is when things will begin to be revealed and that light will shine out even more clearly. Now, a bit early, but have you made your Christmas list yet? Anybody made it? Are you dropping big hints to people to say, hey, by the way, this is what I would like for Christmas? Some people got a really good gift actually buying presents. I think I've got a really good gift for receiving presents. So just saying everybody, good gift for receiving presents. You know, but do you ever get to Christmas and you see these presents there and you drop loads of hints about what you want and then you're unwrapping the paper and you can't wait to get in it? Socks again. Unless you wanted socks, unless that's on your list. Socks again. The anti-climax, right? Well, think about it. The reign of God has come. That's what Jesus said. The kingdom of God has come into the world. The light has come, as Isaiah promised. Jesus talks about the kingdom of God coming into the world, but we begin to see people's disappointment. And we've been unpacking this more on a Wednesday as well, how the religious leaders were starting to get increasingly frustrated. Initially, they thought, well, this might be a chance. It might be the person. Now, not a chance. Even to the point that a couple of weeks ago, they turned around to Jesus and said, you are Satan. Couldn't get much worse and damning than that, right? You see, the people have been waiting for a long time. They had these prophecies in the Old Testament telling them that the kingdom of God would come, that a descendant of King David would come on the throne. And the Old Testament describes this time as a new creation. People knew the teaching. They were waiting for it. Remember right at the beginning of Mark, when the people turned up en masse for that baptism of repentance that John the Baptist brought. Because that was part of getting ready. That their Messiah had come. And now, like, they look at Jesus and go, yeah, okay. Well, obviously it wasn't him then, was it? And they look at the end product and the beginning
to doubt that Jesus was who he said he was. Jesus didn't even look like King David. Where's his crown? Where's his throne? Where's his army? I mean, he's got a bunch of like straggly disciples of fishermen and a tax collector and some women. What is that about? But we've begun to see as we looked at the first couple of chapters of Mark that Jesus isn't actually tearing down their expectations in the Old Testament, but he's getting them to re-look at what they expected, pointing out to them that actually they'd seen things slightly wrong. And at the Transfiguration, and we'll get back to that in Mark chapter 9, Transfiguration, when Jesus appears on a mountain with Elijah and Moses, we begin to get a glimpse of what is to come, Jesus our Messiah, Jesus our Savior. And we get that voice again, just like we had at the baptism, where the Father declares, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And then Jesus points to Mark 14 again. We'll get to that probably around like March time, I don't know. At what we call the parousia, the second coming of Jesus. And Jesus gives us a foretaste. And he says, "And you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming in the clouds of glory." And you can imagine at that point, the Pharisees, religious leaders, were really annoyed with him. Jesus has come to establish his kingdom. It's understandable we get a bit frustrated, don't we? I mean, we look around us and we go, well, has it really arrived? Why is there so much sickness and bereavement in my life? Why is my health messed up? Why am I struggling with anxiety and frustrations and work stuff and home stuff and relationships? And where is Jesus? Why in the world is there so much famine and disease if Jesus has brought in his kingdom? If the light has come into the world, why don't my friends and family recognize that Jesus is the one? But you see, Jesus is bringing in this new age. But we know we're still in this in-between time. He's giving people a chance to come to know him and sending us out as his disciples, his missionaries. This old age, the work of Satan, is still with us. It hasn't gone away yet. Satan is wounded from Jesus' resurrection. And that's why we live with these struggles and challenges. Jesus is also pointing to a time when that will change. Now, we know that if you have a good diet, right, and if you go to the gym, you do some exercise, then you'll see the end results, or hopefully see some of the end results, right? And if you don't, if you're lazy and you snack and you do all that stuff, then you'll also see those results. I'm not saying that make you uncomfortable, I'm just saying that we know sometimes that you get into it, what you put into it. Get out of it what you put into it. And there's this verse 24, with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. And this is a very common Jewish saying. We may have come across it, we may not have done. You'll get out of it what you put into it. And Jesus says to people, pay attention. Listen to what I am telling you. Listen to me. We've heard that before, right? The last couple of weeks, where Jesus is like, listen! Don't just hear me. Listen to what I'm saying. Jesus is saying, listen. Put some effort in so you'll really understand what I'm telling you. Because the more you listen, the deeper your faith will grow. Paul tells us in Galatians chapter 6, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please their flesh, from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. So, Jesus is the light, right? He's come to be with us. But how can we, at Glory Day, in a sense, pay attention to it? You know, how is the Lord speaking to us and leading us on? Now, one of the reasons why we did the story last year, and we're doing the Mark's Gospel this year. It is one of my aims is we learn what the Bible is telling us about Jesus. That we get excited when we read God's Word. And we learn and we grow. And then that begins to show in and through our lives as our foundation is on Jesus. And then it begins to transform our prayer lives as we begin to trust in the Lord God, that He is with us and that His will be done. And as we grow confidence and we trust in Jesus, you know, we long to see more people have a chance to hear the message. And we go out, we love our neighbors, and we demonstrate the love of Jesus to them. You know, it's no point just going through Mark and turning up each week and just going through the motions. My prayer is that, like the early disciples, we let Jesus put a smile back on our spiritual faces. And you know, even though we're only a small church, we're with more people at the top end of their lives than at the bottom end. It doesn't matter, right? Because the more we're focused on the Lord, the more we'll begin to be like Ezekiel talks about those dry bones that are dancing full of the Spirit. Or we'll soar, as Isaiah puts it, on the wings of the eagles. Because we don't hide the light of Christ. Do you want this? Do you want to grow in your faith and be able to totally trust Jesus for the way ahead? Because that's the best thing that will happen in your life. You know, as you live out each day with such joy and with such excitement, that the glow of the Holy Spirit will shine out through you to other people. Because Jesus says, for the one who has, more will be given. But you hear that warning? From the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. Now, we've been watching the Pharisees, right? We've been watching their interaction with Jesus. And it looked initially as though they had it all spiritually together. But soon Jesus is going to say to them, you're going to have nothing. You're going to have nothing. Jesus brings this warning about doing nothing with what they hear of God's word. Are we falling into the same trap sometimes of going through the motions, of showing up and then leaving? Because Jesus said there's going to be a time of judgment. You know, if you come to the Lord in faith, hungry and thirsty for God, He will fill you and He will satisfy you and you'll be blessed, and God will give us more of Himself. And then Jesus moves on to this other parable, okay? Parable of the mustard seed. The seed which starts off so small that you can actually fit 700 mustard seeds into a gram in weight. And then I realized you don't think about things in grams, but I don't know what the version is in ounces, so it doesn't matter. This is like very, very small seeds, okay? Just take it from me. Actually, I've got to confess up here, in case you come back and say to me, Jesus is wrong. The mustard seed isn't actually the smallest seed that there is, but it's a hyperbole, okay? It was used by the Jews as an illustration. People would know what Jesus is saying. The mustard seed, small and unimpressive. But then, so were Jesus and his group of disciples, right? They came from an area of Galilee. Can you get any more insignificant? But Jesus' small beginnings in Galilee were just the start of what God was going to do. And this plant, and it's a plant, it's not a tree. This plant becomes the biggest plant in the herb garden. It grows from, you know, 8 to 12 feet tall. And it begins to take on these tree-like qualities. And the Jews, well, they expected the kingdom of God when it came to be, in a sense, like this parable. So they got half of what Jesus was saying. They expected this kingdom of God to fill the whole world. But you see, the seed is sown, it lays in the ground, but then it grows and it rises. And that word rises, it's actually the same word that's used for the resurrection.
Jesus will be laid in the ground, but he will rise. You know, as I said, the people listening, they weren't thinking about Jesus, they were thinking about this tree, how it is Israel, and all the Jews would flock to come back. And they weren't thinking about the Messiah rising again. They thought the promise was just for them. And that's why they got frustrated with what Jesus was saying, I think. Israel is a great nation. But listen, what comes to rest in the branches? Did you read that? What comes to rest in the branches of this tree? But the birds of the air, birds of every nation. So Jesus, be patient, because over time, the kingdom of God is going to grow, and it's going to grow big. This growth is going to start slow. And it felt slow for them, and it feels slow for us sometimes, right? But be patient. Now, we get a problem with being patient. I have a problem with being patient. We get frustrated, we despair. Oh, boy, we worry that our nation is becoming increasingly unchristian, that our children are drifting away, young people are even running out the doors. We're concerned that our church, both nationally, here, is getting smaller. And I think sometimes our enemies look on and think they're winning. But take heart from this parable. This tiny thing, this tiny mustard seed, the Christian faith, Jesus says is going to become the greatest of all kingdoms. And every tribe and nation and language and tongue will find rest in God's kingdom. Now, every morning I check the weather to see what I should wear. I expect you all do it as well, right? You're Minnesotans. It's actually one thing that Minnesotans and English people have got in common. They always think about the weather, and they always talk about the weather as well. In England, we go, talk about the weather, it's raining. Oh, okay, raining again. It's always raining. So here at least it's not always raining. But we look at the weather to see what should we wear. And then when we go outside for a walk, we know we dress right. Okay, you got it? And as much as we want to, we can't change the weather, can we? We can't change the weather. Actually, next week, we're going to hear about how Jesus actually does change the weather, and that really got the disciples worried about it. Come along next week, because you're going to help me change the weather, okay? We'll get excited about that. We can't change the weather, but we can put on the right clothes in order to adapt and make the most of the situation. You know, I also share your worries. It's not just a feeling. It's a reality. Numbers declining. It's easy to be discouraged, and for good reasons, especially when we think about those that we love, right? We despair because it's like God's kingdom is failing them. And we discourage because sin and wickedness is taking over. But don't despair, Jesus. Put on the right clothes to suit the weather. Let the word of God do its work. The seed is still being sown. It wasn't just a one-off. It's still being sown. And it's being sown in the lives of those we love and those around about us. Pray for that seed. And it's why we have sermons. It's why I encourage you to have Bible studies together and on your own and pray. It's why we come together to ask the Lord God to move, so we can let God do his work in growing the kingdom. You know, as Mark's readers reading this in AD 50s, they were seeing persecution all around them. And they must have thought about Jesus talking about growing the kingdom and thought, what is he on? That is not going to happen. And that 120 people who gathered at Jesus' ascension, by Pentecost, they just added another 3,000. And then in AD 350, it's going to go up to 30 million followers across the Roman Empire. And today, 2.5 billion Christian brothers and sisters gather together. And today on Sunday, they gather from every corner of the globe, and they recite the same creed that we recite. They say the same Lord's Prayer. They receive the same sacrament as we do. Just like we saw with the Liberian church last week. You know, in many parts of the world, Christians are being harassed and persecuted.
But you know, that's also the place where we've heard before, that's where the message of God is growing also. You know, and countries like the West here, USA, England and others, you know, people think, well, you've had your heyday. But we pray that the Western Christians and the Western culture will sit up and take notice and listen to Jesus' message to come back to the gospel. So be encouraged. Be encouraged. You know, we look at our congregation, we see the fruits of all God has done. And you tell me stories how over the years we've grown and we've encouraged and we've supported and we've sent out missionaries across the states and across the world. And this parable reminds us that God's kingdom is moving towards a point. We're reminded ourselves of how it will end in the end. Who will have the final victory? There are two words that describe what we call eschatology, the end times. Two words are Jesus wins. Jesus wins. Now, what season is your favorite? I love summer because it's warm. You might love the fall, especially in the minute with those leaves and those colors. Awesome. Some of you might like winter. I will be praying for you afterwards. But God made all the seasons. And it might like feel like winter in your life, and in our nation, and in our church. And we long for summer, when the birds will be making the nests in our trees. But at the minute, it seems like all the birds have flown south for the winter, and the leaves have fallen from the trees. But you know, if you're a gardener, the best time to prune a tree is actually when there aren't any leaves on it, sometime in March. And why do you prune a tree? So that it will grow and it will get the best growth out of it. So when the young birds come in spring, they'll be able to make their nests in the branches. You know, a few people gathered together, praying, studying God's word, might very well be the start of a big tree. Because God is not incapable, God is not powerless to turn around things that we see in Him. We're simply called to listen to Him and seek where He calls us to lead. We might become a little deaf, right? We might need to turn up our hearing aid a little bit. And that maybe is why it's taken us a little while. But don't worry, Jesus is saying, remember who your God is. Remember what He has promised you. This small beginning, this mustard seed, is part of God's kingdom, which will shelter the world. Will you pray with me? Father God, we're sorry that we get frustrated sometimes. We struggle with trusting You. And Lord, we look at some of the challenges we face. And we ask, why, Lord God, do we go through this? Lord God, give us ears to hear You, to really listen. And Lord God, give us feet planted in You and in Your foundation, knowing that we can turn to You in prayer and read Your word. And Lord God, we pray that You may grow our church, both spiritually, Lord God, and numerically as well, both here, across the country, and across the world. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And so we come to recite our creed together. Remember that it is Christians across the world who are saying these same words together. If you're able to, will you please stand with me? And join with me as we say the creed together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of all.
Dale to bring up the communion, the offerings, please take a seat a moment. And then after that, we're just going to have a few prayers, if you like, remembering those who've died since last All Saints Day, but also those who've also passed on over the years that come to our mind as well. So as we're quiet, be remembering those ones that we've lost. Maybe have a picture in your mind, those memories that you've got. We'll be praying together for those in a moment. But Father God, thank you for blessing us with the gifts that we have. We pray, Lord God, you may use these to further the growth of your kingdom in this world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we're quiet, we call this the commemoration of the faithful departed. We're not praying for those who've passed, but we're remembering them. We're remembering also those who are here with us who mourn those who we've lost. Let us remember with thanksgiving those who have gone before us with the sign of faith, for they were created by God to offer him praise and thanksgiving forever. God gave new life to them through holy baptism, nourished them in the company of his people at his holy table, and in his mercy summoned them to his eternal presence, so that they continue to serve him forever. In joyful expectation of the resurrection to eternal life, we remember before you, O Lord, these relatives, friends, and fellow members of this congregation who have gone before us in faith. We offer thanksgiving for the gift of faith and hold fast to the certainty of your promise that where you are, there your servants shall be also. Lord, in your mercy, continue in our prayers. And I'd like to say a prayer for Veterans Day, which is coming up this week. Lord God, you have sustained our nation in the past and continue to bless us. We recall how so many have given their lives for the cause of freedom. Men and women continue to sacrifice and serve in the armed forces today. As Lord God, we pause and reflect and honour those who gave or continue to sacrifice so much in the defence of our freedom to be faithful. Lord, in your mercy. Sarah, our DC intern, is at a mission conference called Beautiful Feet in Chicago. Let's pray for Sarah and for the group there. Father God, thank you for these young people who are gathering together to think about mission. Lord God, we pray that you may encourage and inspire them. Lord God, keep their eyes fixed on you and lead them in the way that you are leading our country and these young people. Lord, in your mercy. And we turn to pray for those people we know of who are sick or struggling at this moment. And I invite you in the quietness as you come before the Lord to lift up to him those people that you know of who need the Lord's healing touch at this time. Lord God, as we remember those that are dear and near to us, pray also, Father God, those that we've been called on to pray for as a church. Father God, we lift up to you Jean. Father God, we pray for Walter. Lord God, have your hand upon Rudy this week. Pray, Lord God, for Millie, for Bob and Dolores. Father God, we lift up to you Mary and Barney. Father God, we pray for Dorothy. Lord God, we lift up your brother Aaron. Continue to pray for your hand upon Ben, Lord. Father God, we praise you that Shirley is back with us today. Thank you for the treatment that she received. Lord God, we lift up to you Lil and Bill and all our shut-ins. Father God, we continue to pray for Al, that you may bring him safely through this bout of COVID, and also Juliana, Lord, as well.
Thank you for keeping Pam and Aaron safe, Lord God. Father God, we pray for the relatives of Eleanor. Have your hand upon them. Lord, we pray for Bruce and Ashley. Lord God, we pray for our neighbours, Lil and Mary, especially, Lord God, have your hand upon Lil. Father God, we pray for your continued hand of healing upon Katie. Father God, we lift up to you, Joanne. Lord God, we pray for Kevin. Lord, have your hand upon him, we pray. Father God, we pray for Gwen's neighbours and also her relatives who are struggling. We pray for your presence there. We lift up to you, John, Lord God. Pray for Susan. Lord God, we pray for Paul. Father God, we pray for all those who work in healthcare. We lift up to you, James. Father God, we pray for John and also his fiancée, Patty, as they've, and their family who've all got COVID, Lord. Bring healing to them. Father God, we lift up to you, Roxy and Amy. Father God, we pray for Warren and Ty, and also Dale and Amy, Lord, as well. And Lord, also those that we mentioned in the choirs. Use us, Father God, as instruments of your healing. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
One of the joys of coming together is we can celebrate God's meal together. And again, it's something that we do here, and people across the world celebrate also. They receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And as Jesus is teaching his disciples, part of that teaching was that visual teaching. And Jesus continues to teach us today. And in this meal, we receive that forgiveness, and that joy of that healing. So we come now to receive Christ's body and Christ's blood. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." Towards the end of the supper, Jesus took the cup and he said, "Drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of your sins." He said, "To do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." May the peace of the Lord be with you always, and also with you. So I invite you to take up your hat, the sign with the wafer. Receive the body of Christ broken for you. And as you turn it over, this is the blood of Christ shed for the forgiveness of your sins. I'm just going to pray a prayer of blessing over Finn at the back there. Finn, you're a child of God. May the Lord bless you today. Amen. Will you pray with me? Father God, thank you that we can receive your body and your blood. Father God, thank you that through that we can receive forgiveness and the power and strength of your Holy Spirit and life everlasting. And Lord God, as you've equipped us, will you please bless us to send us out to be making disciples of all nations. We ask this in Jesus' name. As we come to the end of our service, we're going to sing a song, "Shine, Jesus, Shine," which talks about just exactly that. Fill this land with the Father's glory. It's our prayer and our desire that we see God continue to work in our nation. If you're able to, please stand with me as we sing together. coffee at the back, please stick around and chat for a bit afterwards, but remember to keep our social distance going. Today we've thought about some of the more teaching of Jesus. And hopefully we've been encouraged that even though the mustard seed is so small, God is still growing his kingdom. And even though we might despair and we look at our own life and the situations around about us and go, God, where are you? We take comfort in these passages to know that God is still working out his process, working out his kingdom, even here at Gloria Day. And God is sending each one of us out in the power of his Spirit to be his witnesses, to love God and to love our neighbors, using words only if necessary. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine down upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.